Good morning, students. Myself Lokesh, working as assistant professor in Vignan R.I. Institute of Technology and Science. So, welcome to the next lecture on ground improvement techniques. So, with our last class, we have completed the third unit. Okay, that is chemical stabilization of soil. So, the fourth unit is reinforced earth. So, as we already discussed, what is the meaning of reinforcement? Reinforcement means provision of some support. Okay, in civil engineering, whenever you heard a reinforcement, you remember that it is a steel. Okay, so we are using the reinforcement in concrete structures. So there, steel is known as a reinforcement. Why? Because concrete is very weak in compression, weak in tension and strong in compression. So in order to increase the tensile strength of concrete, we are providing the steel. That means we are providing the support to the concrete. So that's why steel is known as a reinforcement. Okay. But steel is not only the reinforcement, whatever the material you are provided to support another material, that is known as a reinforcement. Here, we are reinforcing the earth. So similar to the concrete, the tensile strength of earth or a soil mass is very very less. So we are improving the soil capacity by providing some extra material. Those are known as a reinforcement. Okay. So the entire mass is known as a reinforced earth. Okay, so in this entire unit we are going to discuss what are the various elements we can use to support the earth. Okay, we mainly discuss about the retaining walls. Okay, so only in case of retaining walls only we need to provide some support to the earth to not to fall at the other side. So let's see the syllabus. This is the very easiest unit. It contains only 5 topics. Okay, so if you observe your previous year question papers also, one question must be there from these 5 topics. So this one is very very easy one. The previous one is also very easy because it has 6 stabilization methods. All are very similar to each other. Okay. Here we have only 5 components. Out of 5, the second one is very very easy. Stability checks. We have only 2 stability checks. Soil nailing is a somewhat different topic when compared to these 4 topics. These 4 topics are regarding what are the various materials we use to reinforce the soil, and here it is somewhat different, that's it. So if you learn these 5 topics, then you will easily write a essay question. So let's start with the first one. What are the principles of reinforced earth? So that is our first topic. So before that, let's see the basic introduction. So what is a reinforced earth or reinforced soil? If you see, reinforced wall, reinforced earth wall is a combination of earth and linear reinforcing strip. Linear means nothing but a horizontal and straight forwarding reinforcing strips. So how we are providing the support to the earth in terms of strips, small strips we use to insert into the soil. Okay, like that we are going to improve the strength. So how we are going to improve the strength, what is the load transferring mechanism, that we will discuss. Okay. So that are capable of bearing the large tensile stresses. So what we are doing is we are combining the earth and linear reinforcing strip such that it is capable of bearing the tensile stresses. That is the concept. Soil is very strong in compression but weak in tension. If you apply any tensile load on a soil mass, it will easily collapse without any resistance. So that's why what we are doing, we are providing some reinforcement. Okay, but the reinforcement is strong in tension. So if you combine these two, then the reinforced earth is strong in compression and also strong in tension. Okay, that is our concept. The reinforcement provided by the strips. So whatever the strips that we are providing, they are enable the soil to resist the tension in a way which earth alone could not. That means if you apply any tensile stresses, the earth could not resist them. But if you provide these strips, those are enabling the reinforced air to resist the tensile stresses that are not can be bearing by the normal soil, okay, or normal earth alone. So that is the first point. So what is the source of the resistance? You are providing some horizontal strips into the soil. But what is the source of resistance? That means due to which we are resisting these tensile stresses. So the source of resistance to tension is the internal friction of soil. If you see, we have discussed about cohesionless soils and cohesive soils, right? Cohesionless soils are having internal friction value high value. Internal friction means, if you see, these are the soil particles. Okay, so between two soil particles, there might be a contact. Okay, obviously, two soil particles must be in contact. So if you apply load, any load, the particle tries to move in a downward direction. But because of the friction, the development of friction between the two soil particles, it can resist this external loading whatever we apply. Okay, so the reason is here, this is the strip we provided. The internal friction between the soil and the strip, between these two materials, there is a development of friction. So that friction is resisting the tensile stresses, that is the source of resistance to tension. Okay, because the stresses that are created within the mass are transferred from soil to the reinforcement strips by friction. If you see, even in the case of reinforced concrete structures also, the tensile loads are transferred to the steel, okay, through the concrete. Here also, whatever the load we apply on the soil, that entire load is transferred into the strips between the friction, because of the friction between the soil and the strip. Okay. See, in the ancient times, ancient means very very old times, the reinforcement we generally used is tree branches. That means nothing but if we are going to cut the branches of a tree and they are going to place as a strips, and also roots of the vegetation. Roots of the vegetation means we generally use it for crops and all, right? So that can also be a plank out of the crop and we can insert into a soil. Then we have tree trunks, straws, or mostly bamboos. If you see the ancient reinforcement means, in those days they use the bamboos as a strips. Okay. But in the modern reinforcement, we are not using all those types. We are using a steel rod, nothing but a steel member, a longitudinal steel member that is inserting into a soil. Or a concrete, even glass fibers also we can use. Wood members, rubbers, or aluminiums. So in the present reinforcement days, we are using all these type of materials as a reinforcement to the soil. Next one is retaining wall. See, so we are talking about this one. This is the retaining wall and this is the soil or earth. So if you apply any load, there might be a development of tensile stresses in the soil. So the soil alone cannot bear the tensile stresses. So what we are doing? We are inserting some strips. Okay, this is a steel strip or a concrete strip. Like this we are inserting into the soil. So when you apply the load, the load is transferring from the soil to this strip through the friction between these two. Okay, so like that the work is going on. So let's talk about this retaining wall. Okay, retaining walls are generally used to retain the earth. That is the purpose of using the retaining walls. Not only the earth, but other materials, if any, which have the tendency to slide and repose at a particular inclination. That means, like this, it might not be a soil, but any other material that has a tendency to move at a, to fall at a particular inclination. So that is the main purpose of using these retaining walls. They are lateral support, they provide lateral support to the earth. Lateral support means horizontal support. So in this direction, the retaining wall is providing the support for this earth, whatever is there, earth field, embankments and other any materials, in order to hold them in a vertical position. So what is the other purpose of providing these retaining walls? To hold all these backfill soil in a vertical position, not to get fall into the other side. That is the purpose of using these retaining walls. See, simply this is a reinforced earth. If you see this color soil, this soil is not capable of resisting any tensile stresses. So what we are doing? We are inserting these strips into the soil. So here we have a total of 7 layers. So in 7 layers, we are inserting the strips. So when the car is moving over the road, the stresses are transferred from soil to the strips. Okay, the strips can resist the tensile stresses, but the soil alone cannot resist. So likewise, we are providing the reinforcement to the soil, and this is a reinforcement wall, sorry, retaining wall. So here it is made up of a facing panels, that is terra trail, that is the name. These are none are the facing panels. So we are inserting in like tiles under, we see, right? So here the wall is a paneled wall, and this is a backfill, this is a reinforced earth block. Okay, so then we also provide some drainage layers. Why? If you do not provide any drainage facility for the water to escape, then what will happen? Along with the soil, the water also impart the lateral pressure on the retaining wall. So that pressure is very very high. So that's why we generally provide some drainage paths to allow the water to escape. If there is a way to escape, it will not apply any pressure. Okay, so that is the concept. Simply, this is a reinforced earth. Coming to the first topic, principles of reinforced earth. If a vertical stress is, that means a vertical load is applied on a soil element, what will happen? It undergoes a vertical compression along with a lateral deformation. Vertically compressing means what is happening? It is laterally deforming. Okay, that is the concept. If you apply any vertical load, it will get compressed. So how it will get compressed? By expanding in a lateral direction. If a reinforcement is added, this is without the reinforcement, but if we add the reinforcement to the soil in the form of horizontal layers like this, these are the horizontal layers. So if we add these horizontal layers to the soil, what will happen? The soil element will be restrained against the lateral deformation. That means the soil is not going to deform in the horizontal direction. So if you apply the load, it will get compressed, that by increasing in this two direction, it is expanding in the lateral direction. Okay, but if you provide the strip, that can be restrained or preventing the horizontal deformation as it acted by a lateral force. If you see, if you apply any vertical force sigma v, we have applied some vertical force sigma v. Okay, so the black color is the original shape of the soil before applying the stress. So once we apply the stress, what will happen? This black shape becoming like this, it get compressed. How? By expanding in the two dimensions. So this one is known as a horizontal deformation, and this one is known as a vertical deformation, delta V and delta H. Okay, this is the general phenomena without the reinforcement. But if you apply the reinforcement in terms of horizontal layers, this is the soil, we have provided the reinforcement in horizontal layers. If you apply a load sigma V, there must be no deformation in the lateral direction. Delta H is equals to zero. If you provide the reinforcement, there must be no lateral deformation. If there is no lateral deformation, just imagine here we have a retaining wall. Okay, if there is no deformation under the vertical load, there might be no pressure on the retaining wall. If there is a deformation, in order to provide the deformation, the soil tries to apply the lateral pressure on the retaining wall. If there is no deformation, there is no lateral pressure. Okay, so this is the concept. One more doubt, you may get a doubt that why delta H is zero and what is the process, how the delta H is becoming zero. Okay, if you apply any vertical load, the delta H, that means the deformation in the horizontal direction, is becoming zero. So how it is possible? Let's see. So see this image, this is the retaining wall, and these are the reinforcement in horizontal layers. Okay, if you apply a vertical load here, what will happen? It is going to impart some lateral force. Okay, that means the soil is going to deform it laterally. But here you have to observe the friction between the soil and the panel element. So the friction is acting in the opposite direction. So whatever the lateral force developed due to the vertical force, you have applied a vertical force, due to that a lateral force has developed. So in order to counteract this lateral force, there is a development of friction between the soil and the reinforcement. Okay, so these lateral forces are counteracting by this friction, such that there is no development of deformation. Okay, so this is with the reinforcement. Okay, so this is how this is how the reinforcement is going to work. This is the principle of reinforced earth. Okay, principle means nothing but the load transfer mechanism, not exactly the load transfer mechanism. What are the actions that are going to take place when you apply the load? That is the principle. Coming to the next topic, components of reinforced earth. So the reinforced earth consists mainly three components. That is soil or backfill, we say. The second one is skin, or we also known it as facing. Skin or facing. And the last one is reinforcement. Okay, if you see, this is the arrangement, right? So this is the arrangement. This entire one is known as a soil. This vertical face, okay, this is known as a skin or facing. And this reinforcement in horizontal layers, these are known as the reinforcement. So these are the three components of a reinforced earth. So let's see one by one. So you can see here, see, this is the retaining wall, or we call it as a facing. Okay, besides it, from here we use it to provide some reinforcement bars in the horizontal direction, like here, into the soil up to this one. There we use it to lay the soil. Okay, we are going to backfill the soil. These are the three components. So coming to the first one, the backfill. Okay, the fill material for reinforced earth structure shall be preferably cohesionless soils. Why? We discussed about the development of friction between the soil particles. If it is a cohesionless soils, then only there is a development of friction. There is a development of more friction between the soil and the horizontal layer. This is a horizontal reinforcement layer, and these are the soil particles. If these are cohesionless, then only there is a more development of friction between the soil and reinforcement layer. Then only we can counteract the lateral forces. Okay, so that's why if the soil is cohesionless, then there might be a development of friction between the reinforcement layer and soil. So that's why mostly we prefer a cohesionless soil as a backfill. Okay, and it should have an angle of internal friction between the compacted fill and reinforcing element. That means you have to compact it. So after compacting the soil, the internal friction between this compacted soil and the reinforcing element, that should not be less than 30 degrees. Such type of soil only we have to measure, we have to consider. Okay, that 30 degrees is measured according to the IS 13326 part 1. So according to that, the angle of internal friction between the compacted soil, the soil after compacted, and the reinforcing element should not be less than 30 degrees. That we have to consider. So it must be a cohesionless, and the angle of internal friction should not be less than 30 degrees. And the soil should have properties such that the salts, obviously if it is a soil, it contains some kind of salts. Okay, so the soil should have the property such that the salt in the soil should not react chemically or electrically with the reinforcing state. For example, you have placed the reinforcement bars here, and this is the soil. If the soil contains any salts, okay, the salts may chemically or electrically react with these two reinforcing elements. Okay, that may result in the failure of these two reinforcing elements. Okay, we discussed that the lateral force is counteracting by the friction between the soil and the reinforcing element. But if the friction is less or the lateral force is more, then the element is also going to break. Okay, so we have to be sure that there is a development of more friction. Okay, so if the salts in the soil react with this reinforcing element, then the development of friction between the soil and the reinforcing element is reducing. Okay, that means the lateral force, whatever developed, that cannot be counteract by the friction between the soil and reinforcing element. So there we may face the failure of a structure. So that's why the soil should not contain any salts. If it contains the salts, The zone should not react chemically or electrically with the reinforcing strips. That we need to remember. And we also use fly ash as a black backfill. But the fly ash must be conforming to IRC SP50L. That only can be used as a reinforced as well as retained soil. Okay. We are not only retaining the soil. We can also retain the fly ash. But we have some recommendations or confirmations. Coming to the what is the selection of soil for the reinforced zone. Okay. We have to select some kind of soils only to retain. The retaining wall cannot retain all type of soils. We have to choose only certain type of soils to retain. So in that, the first point we need to remember is it should be a granular, cohesionless material. Granular means somewhat larger in size, not that much larger, and a cohesionless material. Okay, the soil must be a cohesionless material. Then only we can retain that type of soils. Not too much salt, silt and clay. Having a particle size not more than, it's 125 mm, not 12.5, it is 125 mm. Okay, so the soil must be a granular, cohesionless material, should not contain large amount of silt and clay, and the size is also not more than 125 mm. Okay, that is the first condition. The second condition is, the plasticity index shall not exceed 6. So the plasticity index should not be more than 6. What is the plasticity index? The difference between the liquid limit and the plastic limit, that is known as the plasticity index. So that should not be more than 6 for the selected soil. The materials shall be substantially free from shale or other soft, poor durability particles. Shale is also a type of the soil, but is a highly compressible soil. So the soil should be free from shale and other soft or poor durability property soil. So the soil should not contain all these types. The fill material must be free from organic matter also. So the soil should not contain any organic matter, and the deleterious substances, that means those have to delete. So it should not contain any deleterious, that means removing substances as the materials not only enhance the corrosion. So if it contains some deleterable or removable substances, those are not only causing the corrosion but also results in excessive settlement. Okay, that means the soil is going to settle if the removable substances are present in the soil. So that's why we need to remember all these points. The next one is, we can use peel gravel. Peel gravel is generally recommended to prevent the buildup of high lateral pressures from the compaction and to prevent the facing panel movement. If we use, generally peel gravel is recommended. Why? To prevent the buildup of high lateral pressures from the compaction and to prevent the facing panel movement. So if you use the peel gravel, we can achieve these two. Okay, we can prevent high lateral pressure during the compaction, and we also prevent the facing panel movement, that means the retaining wall movement. Okay, so what is this peel gravel? It is a backfill material of good quality in both friction and drainage. That means it is a backfill material having good friction and good drainage properties. We discussed that mostly we have to choose cohesionless soils. Why? In cohesionless soils, the drainage is very very good. That means the permeability of cohesionless soils is very very good. So even if there is any water, the water can easily escape through the cohesionless soils. Okay, that is another point. So with this, we have to remember all these points before selecting the backfill material. The second one is skin or facing. Skin is the facing element of the reinforced soil wall. So whatever is the facing, whatever we are seeing, that is the skin or a facing. See, this is the facing. Behind it, we have the soil to retain. Okay. See, this element keeps the reinforcement at a desired elevation. So how do you think that? So how the reinforcement is at this level only, it may get settled, right? And like this. So in order to keep all these reinforcing layers at a desired elevation, we are using this skin or facing. Okay, elevation in the reinforced wall, and also protect the granular at the edge falling off. That means at the edges, just imagine there is no facing. What will happen? The soil in the edges may fail and may fall off, falling off. So in order to prevent the edge soil from falling, we need to provide some facing. Okay. These are generally made up of either metal units or precast concrete panels. Okay. This is generally the panels. Okay. When you are traveling besides the highway, if you look at the highway, you may observe these type of panels. Okay. In the highway. So in the highway, during the high altitudes, the soil is retaining by these panels. Okay. In the highways also, we generally use these reinforced earth structures. The next one is reinforcing materials. So we have completed what is the soil. So what type of soil we have to choose. And what is the skin or facing? That means the front part of a wall. And the next one is reinforcing material, what we are providing inside the soil. That we need to see. A variety of materials can be used as a reinforcing materials. Okay, we can use some variety of materials. Examples are steel, concrete, glass fibers, wood, rubber and aluminium. We can use all these type of materials as a reinforcing material. The reinforcement may be in the form. These are the materials. But what is the form or the shape? This is generally in the form of strips or grids, anchors or sheet materials, chains, planks, even the ropes also, vegetation and combination of these or any other material forms. Okay, we generally provide in the form of a strip or grid or sheet material. In some cases we provide the anchors. These four types we generally use, we regularly use as a reinforcing forms. See, these are the reinforcing materials. Whether a grid form or a strip form. Okay, these are geogrids actually. Here we are using the geogrid as a reinforcing material. Okay, so these are the various forms. See, this we already discussed, right? See, this one is a grid form. We cannot see in this direction, but it is whether it is a anchor, that means a single rod, or it might be a sheet. It is a complete sheet, but we cannot see from this direction. Or it might be a grid. Okay, so these three forms we regularly use in case of a reinforced earth. So the next topic is construction procedure. So we have discussed what are the three elements and what is the reinforced earth and what are the retaining walls. So how we are going to construct them, that we have to see. So the first step is place first row of panels or blocks on a leveling course. So first place one row of blocks. Next, over the blocks with some connections are there. Okay, some lockings and all are also there. So by using this, place the second rail. Insert next row panel blocks, align or clamp them. Clamp means locking each other. So we have to place like this. So the first one is over that we have to provide the second one. Then fill the soil up to the reinforced element level. If you see the cross section, this is the first panel, this one. If you see from the other side, it is the first one. Over that, this is the second one, right? So fill the soil up to this layer. Why? Because here we are going to place the reinforcing material. So fill the soil up to the level of reinforcing material. See, we have filled the soil up to this level and we place the reinforcing bars. Okay. So the next step is lay and fasten the reinforcing elements. Over the reinforcing also lay some another layer of soil. That means, see here. So if you see it from one side, this is the first block. So you have filled the soil and laid a reinforcing element. Over that you place another bar. So up to here again you fill the soil. Then you are providing another reinforcing element. again one more row. So you have to fill up to here. Over the field you have to provide, you have to place a reinforcing element. Like this we have to go to higher heights. See, repeat the same steps 2 to 5 until the entire structure is completed. Okay, so first let's say you have constructed 3 layers. So you have filling the soil up to this one. So from the third one you have to place the reinforcing elements. Again place the blocks up to the 6th one. Again backfill, again reinforcing elements. Like that we have to go up to the higher heights, whatever we require. So this is the construction procedure of a reinforced earth. The next one is load transfer mechanism. How the load is transferring? So that we have to see. Let's see. See, the flexible reinforcement interacts frictionally. So the interaction between the soil and the reinforcing element is through the friction only. So it is frictionally with the soil. Those are resisting the shear stresses in the soil mass. So whatever the shear stresses developing, those can be resisted friction with the help of friction between the soil and reinforcing element. Okay. The shear stress at the interface of the soil. Interface means this one. Okay, this is a reinforcing element, right? And these are the soils, let's imagine. So this is the interface. Okay. So the shear stress at the interface of the soil and the reinforcement. So the interface between the soil and the reinforcement generates strains. Strains means we know the change in length, so it is going to deform. Okay, in the reinforcement, and a tensile force is mobilized in the reinforcement. If you see in the previous example, we said that whatever the lateral force that is developing is counteracting by the friction between the soil and the reinforcing element. If there is any development of shear stresses, what will happen? There is going to be a deformation, or strains are going to develop at the interface. So here the length is going to increase or it is going to decrease based on the intensity of shear stresses. Okay. So if this tensile force, that means the strain in the horizontal direction, that is considering as a tensile force. So if this tensile force exceeds the tensile capacity of the reinforcement, obviously whatever the material you are providing, for example if it is a steel, it has certain tensile capacity. So the strains or the tensile forces developed is more than the tensile capacity of a reinforcement, then the rupture failure occurs. Okay, that is known as a tension failure. That means the reinforcing element may going to split into two pieces. Okay, this is a reinforcing element, right? If you apply the tensile forces like this, what will happen? It is going to fail by rupture. Okay, so that will happen. If deformations are very very high and if the interface is smooth, whether due to the shear stresses the deformations is very very high or the reinforcing element is very very smooth, then what will happen? It is likely to slip. That means if this is a retaining wall, the entire reinforcing bar is going to slip. There might be no development of friction between the soil and reinforcing element. Okay, so it is likely to slip occurs between the soil and reinforcement. That is known as a pull out failure. That means the reinforcing bar is pulling out of the soil. Okay, and for stability we have to consider the tensile failure and we have to consider the pull out failure to be examined. So before we have to make the soil stabilize, we need to consider these two factors. We need to examine the tensile failure and the pullout failures. Okay, then only we can find whether the soil is stable or not. The next one is design of reinforced wall, reinforced earth retaining wall. So obviously we have to design, right, by considering those failures. So let's see, it is a theoretical part only. In the reinforced earth wall, there is two type of stabilities we have to check. Okay, the first one is external stability and the second one is internal stability. So we have to check these two type of stabilities before designing the reinforcing earth. So what is this external stability? External stability means it consider the reinforcement structure as a whole and check the stability for sliding, overturning and all. That means external stability means this is the retaining wall or the panels, these are the panels, this is a reinforcing elements, and this is the soil. Okay, in external stability what we are doing is we are considering all this one as a single material, as a single piece. Okay, so whether this entire part is going to slide, okay, when you apply any external loads, whether this entire part is going to slide to laterally or not, that we have to discuss, and whether this entire part is going to overturn or not, that also we need to consider. Bearing or tilt and slip. Bearing means here the base of the retaining wall is going to fail, as a result it may go to settle down. So whether that is going to have occurring or not, that also we need to consider. Okay, by considering the effect of dead loads, the self weight of the all these materials and other loads, if we apply any, those are live loads or dynamic load, etc. The dynamic load means the more movement of vehicles, that can be considered as a dynamic load. And forces acting on the structure. So by considering all these factors, the entire structure as a whole, we need to check for a sliding, overturning, bearing or slip and tilt. Okay, we have to check all these marks. This is a external stability. The second one is internal stability. That also we need to check. So first we consider the entire material as a single one. Then in internal stability, we have to apply the checks for individual components. That is for the retaining wall, for the reinforcing element and for the soil. See, it covers internal mechanism. That is tension, pull out and failure. Tension failure and pull out failure. Okay. So it covers internal mechanism such as shear within the structure. So because of the shear only, there is a development of tensile force in the reinforcing panel, reinforcing element. Arrangement within the structure, arrangement and behavior of the reinforcement and soil. So this is a very very important topic. If there is no behavior, the backfill cannot behave properly with the reinforcement, there is no development of friction. Okay, so that's why it's very important. So it sets the security for each reinforcement layers. It is going to check the stability for reinforcement layers, the stability of wedges within the reinforced soil. So it is going to apply the stability checks for individual elements, for these reinforcing elements and for the entire soil edge. Okay, so internal means we are going to apply the stability checks for individual components. Okay, so these are the basic modes of failures. The first one is external failure. External failure means the entire structure is considering as a single one. So base sliding, that means the entire structure is going to slide like this, or overturning, the entire structure may overturn. The third one is bearing capacity or excessive settlement. So the soil, the structure is going to settle. So these three are by considering the entire one as a single material. And the second one is internal. Internal means pull out failure. Pull out means, see, this one is okay. Second one is somewhat pulling out of a soil. Like this, the reinforcing elements are pulling out of a soil. That is the pull out. The next one is tensile overstresses. That means here this element is going to fail. See, this reinforcing element is going to fail here. This reinforcing element is going to fail here. Like this, all the reinforcing elements are going to fail here. If you join this, we get a failure plane. And the last one is internal sliding. Internal sliding means the entire structure is not sliding. Only part of the structure is going to slide over the other part. That is a internal sliding. Okay. Then we have the facing. Facing means connection failure. Here the blocks, whatever we constructed, are the panels or the retaining walls. So there is no connection between the retaining wall and the remaining soil. That is a connection failure. The second one is column shear failure. Here the entire soil is not going to fail. Only the block or a retaining wall is going to fail. If you see here, the retaining wall is not straight. So this is not straight. The wall is failing. And the last one is topping. Topping means only a part is going to overturn. The entire structure is not going to overturn. Only a part is going to overturn. That is a topping failure. Only the top part. Okay. So these are the general modes of failures that may occur in a reinforced earth. Okay. So let's summarize today's class. So in today's class, we have started the topic of reinforced earth. Right? And we also see a general topic, what is a retaining wall. Right? Then we see what are the principles. Principles of reinforced earth. So what is the principle of reinforced earth? Then we discussed about the components of reinforced earth. The components of the reinforcement is divided into three components. The first one is backfill or soil. The next one is facing or skin. And the last one is reinforcement. Okay, so this is the regarding components of a reinforced earth. Then we discussed, after the components, we discussed about the failures or the modes of failures. Right? So with this we have completed up to the, and we also discussed about the designs, right? So I forgot. We also discussed the design of reinforced earth. So in this we have to consider two failures, that is tension failure and pullout failures. So we call it as the external and internal failures. Okay. So in our next class we are going to start the soil nails topic. Thank you.